acknowledgement of a history of colonial violence against the original inhabitants of this land, the Pecumseh people. And we gather to acknowledge the liberatory work of radical abolitionists like Sojourner Truth, William Lloyd Garrison, Frederick Douglass, among others. We gather to honor those whose lives have been lost to the racism that pervades our nation. Rekia Boyd, Ty Underwood, Tamir Rice, Sandra Bland, Eric Garner, Alex Nieto, Mike Brown, Mario Woods, and so many more Black and Brown and Native people who have been victims of structural, institutional injustice and police brutality. This symbolic action, we commit to challenging racism. We gather here on Martin Luther King Day to recognize our need to change the racist system that benefit white people at the expense of people of color, people of the global majority. White people, we have to take risks. Every day, people of color take risks in living their lives with full dignity. Today and moving forward, we challenge ourselves and other white people to take risks, to stand up against racist systems, actions, and structures every day. We know that in this process, we will make mistakes. Our goal is to learn from those mistakes and keep showing up again and again. This is our work to do. This banner is just the beginning. We must hold the police department accountable for disproportionate racial profiling of people of color. We must build relationships, support, and follow the leadership of Black and people of color-led groups. We must vote and continue to work with folks of all backgrounds, identities, and abilities to be able to access adequate housing, jobs, and food. We are so lucky to have these gracious members of our community join us, some of whom are mothers, educators, scholars, archaeologists, elected officials, and beyond, to help us develop a vision for what we can work towards. Our speakers include Whitney Battle Baptiste, Deborah Ferreira, Romina Pacheco, and also a performance from the Amherst Area Gospel Choir. And without further ado, join me in introducing the first speaker, Mayor of the City of Northampton, David Narkowitz.
Everybody warm? It's an incredible honor to welcome and join you here on these historic steps to mark this display of a Black Lives Matter banner on Northampton City Hall. I want to thank Western Mass showing up for racial justice or Surge for organizing today's event. It's obviously appropriate that we gather on Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Day, a day holiday highlighting both his incredible legacy as well as the unfinished work in the struggle for racial equality in our country. Despite the progress Dr. King led in the 60s, our nation still struggles with the scourge of racism in 2016. African Americans across our country continue to face individual and institutional racism in housing, education, employment, and the criminal justice system. Dr. King famously wrote from his Birmingham jail cells that, quote, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." The Black Lives Matter movement reminds us that racism, discrimination, and violence against Black citizens anywhere in America is a threat to citizens everywhere in America, including right here in the city of Northampton. This banner is a call to action for our city and region, and hopefully it can serve as an example for other communities. It represents the work we must be prepared to do in order to end racism and discrimination here and everywhere. It represents a willingness to say here and everywhere that Black lives matter. It's not just what we're fighting against, it's also an optimistic vision of what we want our society to be. Black Lives Matter stands for making sure people have access to housing, food, jobs with livable wages, and health care. Black Lives Matter is about improving the lives of all people. It's about making sure that women and girls, queer and trans people, immigrants, and people with disability all have equal opportunity and access to the American dream.
Yes. Yes.
I'm proud to raise this Black Lives Matter banner on our City Hall, and I'm proud to add the City of Northampton's voice to this critical national conversation about racial and social justice. Thank you.
Thank you, David Darkowitz, Mayor, thank you so much. Next, I would like to introduce Dr. Romina A. Pacheco from the Residence Life Department at Smith College. Please give her a warm welcome.
Good afternoon.
Hello.
My name is Romina Pacheco and this is my daughter Asha. We sort of wrote this together. We talked about what I was going to say when I was invited to do this. So let me give you a little bit of context so you understand where I come from. I'm originally from Venezuela. I was born and raised there. And as Corey said, I work at Smith College. So I live here in Northampton. My daughter attends public school here in Northampton. So we feel that we are part of the community, even though I was not born here. So I've had this relationship with the United States for about 20 years now. I'm an immigrant. That's how I identify eventually. And how did I came to Northampton? Okay, so I was working in Maine at a college there. 12 years ago, I got an offer to work at Smith College, so I worked there for a year. While working at Smith, 12 years ago, I met my life partner here in downtown Northampton, a Latin night actually on a Tuesday night, another black immigrant like me from the Caribbean, Haitian specifically. There's a lot of Haitian pride going on today.
Yes.
After working at Smith for a year, I got accepted into a master's program at UMass Amherst. So I went to UMass Amherst full time after that. And a couple of years after that, my brother also came to UMass Amherst to work on his master's degree. At that point, my partner and I decided to get married. Actually, we came up these steps, City Hall, Northampton City Hall, to file for our marriage license. And after that, we actually purchased a home in East Hampton. And the reason I say all of this is because I want you to understand the connections that we have to this area. We had to commute from East Hampton to Amherst because our connection was mainly to UMass Amherst. And in that commute back and forth, we were constantly harassed by the Amherst police, the Hadley police, the Northampton police, and the East Hampton police. Because even though we were part of the community, we were treated often as strangers and as people that didn't belong. And that was our experience, just driving while black. So after, in 2008, we left. My partner at that point had finished his doctorate, got his first job in New Mexico, and we left. We spent a year in Haiti, and when we're in Haiti, we are hearing about all of these killings of black people in the United States in the hands of police. Coming back to the U.S. felt really scary for us. Because we knew in our own bodies, in our own flesh, we had experienced what it was like to be harassed by the police. So after being in a black country where our skin color was not a threat, it felt really scary to come back. I got a job at Smith College again. That's what brought me back here to this area, August last year. And walking around the surrounding neighborhood around Smith, one of the first things I noticed was the Black Lives Matter signs. And let me tell you, for me personally, I got a sense of relief. Because even though it's all something that is only symbolic, for me, coming back to this area on the bad memories that I had of police harassment, it felt really great to be in a place where I felt that if something were to happen, there would be a community around me that would stand up for me and for my daughter and for my partner. So I got asked to think about the significance of having this time here. And to me, that's the significance. The significance is that people like me can feel welcome and can feel that, again, if anything were to happen, there would be a community around us to stand up for us. Now, this is only a step. I don't believe this is the end, that this is just by having a sign up here, racism is only gonna disappear from the valley. But I do think that it's an important first step.
Okay.
But there needs to be more. It should be the beginning of physical conversations, of holding the police accountable, holding each other accountable to really bring racial justice to this area. Finally, my daughter goes to Jackson Street School.
Woo!
Yes. And last Friday, they had an assembly where they talked about bravery. And I was really happy when Asha came home telling me about what bravery meant to her and gave me examples of what acts of bravery meant to her and what that was. And what I want to encourage everyone here today is to think about what acts of bravery you can take in order to make racial justice a reality in the Valley. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. It's so important to share our stories as we come together and learn through each other. Next, we have one of the co-organizers of the Julius Ford Harriet Tubman Healthy Living Community. Please welcome Deborah Ferreira.
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right. How you all feeling out there? A little bit chilly. But hey, we're here to warm you up because this is an incredible, incredible day. I'm here with my sons, Phoenix, Ryzen, and Onyx, Ras Ali, and we're just very blessed that we're able to be up here, share a few remarks with you all, especially on this incredible day, Dr. Martin Luther King Day. I mean, I have to say, honestly, if it wasn't for Dr. King, I wouldn't be able to be up here, my sons wouldn't be able to be up here speak to you today. So just incredible and gracious time for us to be blessed to do that. To be able to, right, not just us be up here, but to be able to work towards fully for everyone to accept us for who we are, right? For them to accept us regardless of race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, gender identity, disability, religion, any of those aspects, that we can be accepted for who we are. And Dr. King was about that. Not just Dr. King, but all the other civil rights movement leaders of that time, right? We have Medgar Evers, we have Rosa Parks, we have Fannie Lou Hamer, we have Malcolm X, we have all the student organizations from that time, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, Black Panther Party, we have the students who started the sit-ins back in North Carolina, we have all the folks from back then. What am I talking about? I'm talking about young people who are out there doing the work, being willing to get arrested, putting their lives on the line with Dr. King, saying that the time is now, we need to make a change. And what is Black Lives Matter doing? Saying the time is now and we need to make a change. Black Lives Matter is comprised of young people again, right? So they picked up the torch from the Civil Rights Movement and saying that this conversation needs to continue on. So I have to still bring up Dr. Martin Luther King, right, and James Baldwin. Y'all know James Baldwin, because their words need to resonate within us. I know the mayor already shared this quote, but it's so important that I'm gonna share it again. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere, all right? And then James Baldwin said, not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it is faced. So what basically saying, look at nation, you gotta look at the dirt, you gotta look at the truth, and really start seeing that we need to uncover it and we need to face it. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere, and we need to do it now. Right. Black Lives Matter is basically saying, Trayvon Martin, where's he at? Why is he here with us, right? Michael Brown, where's he at? Why is he here with us? We need to really take care of all the black lives, all the young people that had a right to live a full life, potential life, in order to change this world. Yes. Isn't that what we're about?
Yes.
That's what Black Lives Matter is about. Looking at police brutality, but also looking at all those other aspects, right? Having access to public education, good public education, right?
Yes.
Having access to good food, access to health care, looking at the mass incarceration of black and Latino people. Why are we looking at these things and starting to dismantle some of these things that are happening? That's what Black Lives Matter is about. Again, young people saying we need to do this work. But I want to say that, you know, as the co-organizer of the Julius Ford Heritage and Healthy Living Community, we've also been doing this work that Black Lives Matter has been highlighting, right? With the Healthy Living Community, what we do is work with young people, bring them out to Plainfield, Massachusetts with Earth Dance, and have them critically think through the social justice lens around some of these issues. We have a right to healthy foods. We have a right to really think about how to be one with nature, environmental justice, taking care of our environment, making sure that we are helping one another, making sure that we listen to each other, because how we do this with Phoenix and Onyx is intergenerational. So for what I mean by that is the voices, all voices count, from the youngest of the youngest to the oldest of the oldest, and everyone in between. We all learn from one another, and we all build together, and making sure that we are supporting. That's what Black Lives Matter is about. Giving everyone a choice, making sure that we're thinking about this, and empowering young people on the day-to-day basis. And then I have to think, when I say Julius Ford, Harriet Tubman, I have to bring their spirits, their resonance into this conversation. So Julius Ford, community activist, he was my late husband, passed away 6 years ago. And some of you know Julius, right? Yeah. I'm talking about co-founder of this Healthy Living Community, where we build with love and unity. And Julius used to say, if we believe in life and we believe in love, the miracle, then we will understand why we cannot be afraid, we cannot run away. Again, the same theme, face it, deal with the injustice, do not be afraid, do not run away.
Yeah.
And then obviously Harriet Tubman, right? Fearless, another ancestor, and she said, every great dream begins with a dreamer. Always remember you have within you the strength, the patience, and the passion to reach for the stars to change the world. All right? So you can't change the world unless you face it. You can't change the world unless you're embracing our young people and giving them an opportunity through all these different ways. Well, what I'm trying to say with you here today is that all of you have the energy. We all need the energy. The first step is putting up this banner, but it's all of us joining and taking part in changing the world together. We can't be afraid. We can't stand on the sidelines anymore. You have to join something. Black Lives Matter, or you have to join Healthy Living Community that's right here locally. You don't have an option to just stand on the sidelines. There's no more sidelines. All right? You are here. There's no more sidelines. It's about standing up. And I'm going to leave you with this. Again, because we're about empowering young people, that our young people are the leaders of today. You hear me? Not leaders of tomorrow. They're the leaders of today. Creating solutions for a better tomorrow. And with that, I'm going to leave you with Phoenix and Onyx, my sons, who I'm going to end off my remarks.
Yeah.
Woo! Yo, Phoenix! Yo, Army!
Phoenix!
I'm just going to say a quote from Martin Luther King Jr. It's, if we don't learn to live together, then we'll all perish together as fools.
Yeah.
I think that means if we don't learn to live together, all of us together as a community, then all of us together, every single one of us together will fall apart together.
Yeah, Oni!
Black Lives Matter.
it's so important to have voices from our community intergenerationally speaking. Now I feel very honored to introduce to you Associate Professor of the Department of Anthropology at UMass Amherst and the Director of the W.E.B. Du Bois Center at UMass. Please put your hands together for Whitney Battle-Baptiste.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. I'm about to rock this joint and get everybody out here warm.
Thank you.
I want to give a shout out to my ancestors. For them, it is because of them that I am here, first and foremost. I want to thank my mom, who is right here, my husband, who just spoke at Edwards Church. I want to say my three children. I have two black boys who are going to grow up to be black men in the United States. Ayotime, Adelomo, and Ololara. Yeah. I want to thank my Amherst family that I see out here. I appreciate y'all out here in the cold. I want to thank everybody up here on this podium. I want to thank the mayor for taking the initiative that's going to put a little pressure, maybe some peer pressure, on the spots around here, like Amherst, East Hampton, Holyoke, Springfield. You know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I want to thank the organizers for contacting me. It's cold. I'm not a cold kind of person, but I'm here. So I want to start off with a quote. I'm going to just throw a lot of quotes, but I want to start off by a quote with someone's name. Actually, one more person, group of people that I want to thank. And I don't care who doesn't like it. I want to thank the Northampton Police Department, who I see across the street. Peace out, y'all. I want to say that we all matter in this conversation, because if we just talk about and not to, nothing changes. So, this is a quote from James Baldwin. I love America more than any other country in this world. And exactly for this reason, I insist on the right to criticize her perpetually. We live in a democracy so far, so we should be able to voice the things that we have to say. Sojourner Truth, just down the road in Florence, spoke out against the kinds of atrocities, not just in terms of women's suffrage, but the terms and the exploitation of black women, people held in bondage. Frederick Douglass gave a speech called What to the Negro Means the 4th of July.
Yes, yes.
The 4th of July is my son's birthday. That's why we celebrate it. Hundreds of thousands of people were still held in bondage when people were celebrating victory and independence in this very country.
Yes, yes.
Anti-black racism is a part of our lives. Whether you want to admit it or not, it started right about 1619, Jamestown. Now I want to, the next level is James Baldwin again. I just want you, as you wonder why, and I'm gonna talk a little bit about why we say Black Lives Matter, and why I want us all to stop being afraid of these three words in the same sentence. James Baldwin said, to be a Negro in this country and to be relatively conscious is to be enraged almost all of the time. So when you walk you meet people and they might not have a smile on their face other than the fact that I'm from New York, so I don't necessarily smile at the drop of a hat. But the idea that sometimes you don't know what the person that you're sitting next to, the person that you're greeting, has experienced. The fact that when I go to public school, I learn about American history from a Europeanist perspective, and I learn about my own history. I know that Rosa Parks was not a tired old woman who just didn't get up.
Yeah.
I know that the the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King was not singing about Kumbaya, let's all get together to a mountain. He was there to talk about social, economic, and racial injustice. So guess what? Black Lives Matter is about social. Social, racial, and economic injustice. If it can happen to us, it can happen to you. Folks who are under the gun right now, people without documents, can we talk about how many of your ancestors got here that might not have had documents?
Well,
Islamophobia.
Go ahead.
Black Lives Matter is a call to arms for all of us as a people. It's not just about all lives matter, because guess what? If all lives matter, black lives would matter anyway, wouldn't they?
Reach! Reach!
So the W.E.B. Du Bois, he talked about a double consciousness, right? It's what we live with. But be able, even if you don't have that veil and you don't live with that veil, you can actually have a conversation with people just to learn a little bit about their life story. Now I want to talk about why this banner coming up right now is so important on this day. People are afraid. They think Black Lives Matter is about violence. They think it's about people who are against some kind of system. But guess what? They said the same thing about people who were marching in Selma.
Well,
Martin Luther King was not arrested because he didn't have a pass. He was arrested because of social, and he was arrested for civil unrest, and he was against the law. Jim Crow didn't want to let him do what he wanted to do. But let me just give a little context to some young people who might not know this. This is a day that we all take for granted.
Yep.
1983, Ronald Reagan signed this holiday into federal law.
Yes.
It wasn't, until 2000 that all 50 states recognized this holiday.
That's right.
Did you hear what I said?
Yes.
This holiday was a fight.
Yes.
This holiday was a fight because why should we acknowledge a man that broke the law, was arrested, was about civil unrest? And then he was assassinated.
Right.
He was assassinated while he was supporting the worker strike in Memphis, of Memphis sanitation workers. He wanted to talk and have everybody unite in terms of, if black lives matter, your lives matter, your economic lives matter. People who work in McDonald's should not be able to pay rent and eat at the same time.
Yes.
Flint, Michigan, people turning off water.
Yes.
Right.
Racism is everywhere, but guess what? Racism filters into other aspects of your lives.
Yes, it does.
This holiday, don't take it for granted. Learn the history of this holiday. Learn how much people had to fight to be able to acknowledge Martin Luther King on an every year basis. This was a fight. Black Lives Matter is just at this moment. Encourage young people, talk to young people, teach young people, connect with young people. Because guess what? If you don't, they're going to figure it out via Twitter. All jokes aside, the movement of the people right now is in social media. The movement of the people right now is instant. We have to be careful. We have to actually embrace and nurture our young people, because they are watching violence across little teeny screens on a daily basis. It's called trauma. It's called visual and social media trauma.
Yes.
We have got to support our young people. We have got to learn more about what Black Lives mean. We have got to understand that the movement is more than just angry, fed up, enraged black people.
That's right.
Well, it's them too. Yes. I just wanted to let you all know that I do understand the trepidation. I do understand sometimes we don't understand. Why can't we all just be one race? When you say you don't see color, you don't see me.
Yeah.
Amen. Yes. When you say that you yes. are colorblind, you erase my experience, my ancestors, and all the things we got to get where we Amen. Are standing today.
So same
diversity, difference should be celebrated. Whatever your race, your religious choice, your gender, your sexual orientation, your ability. A lot of people have said that up here today. Difference is a beautiful thing. In difference, we can be united. Black Lives makes a difference because Black Lives Matter is teaching us, or for some of us, reminding us of that core message. I want you to go out and I want you to share. Even if you don't agree, I bet you today I made you think slightly differently about those three words together.
Amen.
Spread the word. Amen. If you don't agree with it, talk about it with somebody. It doesn't matter. You don't have to agree. That's called difference.
Right.
It's okay. Black Lives Matter on this city hall is extremely significant. And I want to thank the city of Northampton and Surge for having us. Have a great day. And let 2016, let the names be remembered, but let's not add to them. Thank you so much.
Now, there was a great movement afoot. In times where Black people needed strength and courage, they went to church. The Amherst Area Gospel Choir, under the direction of Mrs. Jacqueline Wallace, will be singing Woo. Lift Every Voice and Sing and Don't Make My Vow.
There's a slight change because, you know, Black people like to do that when they get ready to sing. My name is Marisa Wallace, and I am the assistant director of the Amherst Area Gospel Choir. The reason why we started the gospel choir was because it was the only part of in the community where the musical form was not being represented. So, that being said, I would like to thank my ancestors who taught me the importance of music and the freedom that it gives.
I seek a tall, enormous bulge, but see me selling Kululeko. I seek a tall, enormous bulge, but see me selling Kululeko.
Freedom is coming. Freedom is coming.
You can